Now, you viewers of Informed TV on channel 23.1, I'm doing this in Alexandria, Minnesota, even though I'm not on the air here on channel 21, which also keeps me off the air on channel 34.3 in the Wilmer area, because I wanted to see the books of Selective TV, a nonprofit, and state law says I, as a member as well as a press, have a right to do this. But anyway, in the process, you hopefully, if things come in order in my loop of programming, you'll watch the Diversion Project press conference that was done about a year and a half ago, May of 2014. And you'll see the hype from the politicians and the chamber and how we've got all this money secured. Now, I've talked to, I believe his name is Craig Hertzgard, that he and some of the farmers there are against it. And I, if you know him, have him get a hold of me, because I have talked to him. Just al@informedtv.com. al@informedtv.com. And as I try to keep my head above water and keep the signal, get the signal back on and air here in Wilmer and Alexandria and keep it on the air for you folks in the Fargo-Moorhead area and even get up to the Grand Forks Thief River Crookston market yet this winter. And anyway, in this process, you just watched this hype, a half hour shoot from the powers that be, just like we've got here in Alexandria. But when I talked to Craig and some of the other sources, and when I ran for Congress on the Republican side in 2008 in the Republican primary and got over 48% of the vote, just missed by an eyelash, a crack at Colin Peterson, some of his handouts that are not needed to our regional farmers and haven't helped the small towns at all, just helped absentee land owners and huge farm operations, rather than like we did in the 70s when things boomed, all the little towns, all the regional towns all prospered. And that's the way sound economics should be. But anyway, you just watch this hype, and there's a bunch of things that in that, to my understanding, still are not in place, still not funded, and I firmly believe they do not need to be funded. I walked the banks of the North Dakota side as well as the Minnesota side in 2008 when I was running for Congress, got some good insight from what Minnesota was doing, good insight with some of the people on the North Dakota side, thought should be done rather than this massive diversion project of consuming a ton of good land that should stay in crop production, yet still address flood control. Minnesota has taken care of people. The state taxpayers helped the state or the city of Moorhead get that dike up high enough. And I, with all this drain tile, if you watched all my stuff here, I said we need to dig an additional ditch system along the river, either on one side or both, to address flood water in the spring, as well as having adequate water movement, containment for all this drain tile that's going in. So we look at the whole picture rather than just this massive ditch, which will be a great deal for the politicians and the chamber members that are going to get a cut out of this massive waste of money, rather than let's find middle ground, let's do it in a cost-effective basis, let's not waste any more land than we just have to, and let's look at when we improve flood control, we improve it for the summer months for our farmers as well as our communities, and keep the cost down, improve water quality. And that's what I showed on this mile-wide piece going north of Fargo-Moorhead. There's money available through both the state of Minnesota for our side, and I think we can find additional money. But what I'm getting at, there's a crap or creep program that could basically buy out those zigzag openings between the river there and really catch some of the sediment that flows down the river, whether it's early spring or in the summer or fall. So at any rate, I want you to get some insight, and that's why I put this old piece up, because this is what the establishment, this is what the Republicans and the Democrats want to put, these grandiose policies that everybody that is an insider pats them on the back and funds whatever. When reality, if we work together with an organization like Inform TV and work with both sides, the people that want flood control but at the same time want to improve farm drainage in the area and want to see that we do not spend any more money than is absolutely necessary, and look at all the issues involved, including flood insurance, what should be done. So I hope you enjoyed that, but I want you to understand it is that shoot from 2014, not just recently. Excuse me. And now I'm going to show you a piece relating to what really took place on a project in Broadway in Alexandria in 2014 as well. And so that's why I thought it would be a good deal to show both for both communities, and how when I did a true shoot of it, trying to show some things in, and I'll admit I should have edited some of this stuff out, but I think you'll find it interesting. My local people did, and even people from the Twin Cities that come out here on weekends to their cabins, or from up in your region or south of here. I want you to look at this. I'll put three clips, and then I'll put the package deal from the local engineering firm that oversaw the project, and our show how we got conflict of interest till no end here in Alexandria. The person that talking for the engineering firm, and he'll mention how we got in on it on the early stages. Well, yeah, he's also the city engineer. In the case of our city administrator here, our manager, his wife is a partner in the law firm that we hire here in Alexandria. And Alexandria and Douglas County easily should have their own independent engineer now, with the size of the city and size of the county and the needs from the townships that are basically small communities around all these lakes here. And when it comes to a county attorney or a city attorney, we've already got our county attorney, but our city attorney just works part-time, but they run a mind-boggling bill up to the firm right next door that's handled city business for decades. And the general public is fed up with it, but the powers here in Alexandria, they fear City Hall, they fear county government, which is really sad. And with that, I assume you have the same thing going on in the Fargo-Moorhead area. But I'm going to put up what I filmed, and then I'll put up what the state of Minnesota, working with the local engineering firm, as well as some of the businesses that thought it was wonderful and just wanted to focus on the end. And I'll make an additional comment here in this process of a few shoots that you'll find interesting of what it really happened compared to what the city, the state, and the positive business people want the public to know about the project.
Perfect weather to lay concrete here in downtown Alexandria on Broadway and Highway 29, yet there's rumored reports about a concrete issue with the first two lanes that were laid. Inform TV, we're going to be checking back with the city engineer here yet today as they're determining what the state is going to approve or disapprove as they're starting the process of hanging the street signals in downtown Alexandria. Alan Repke reporting. Inform TV, we're going to give you a little insight on what went on today with no concrete being laid. As you can see, we've got a gathering over there, the city engineer, and it appears to be Mayor Carlson or the state engineer. I'm not quite sure from here, but I think it's Mayor Carlson. But we're going to be talking to Tim here in just a few minutes and get some insight on what the issue is with this beautiful weather, yet no concrete was laid in Broadway on downtown Alexandria, Highway 29, going right through town. So stand by, we're gonna get it right from the horse's mouth, so to speak. As you can see, we got beautiful sunny weather this Wednesday, yet nothing really happened with construction other than some of the stop and go light pedestals were being put up on 5th. As you can see down on 5th, the red, yellow, green signals have been worked on 5th and Broadway.
Hi, my name is Lane Kalena, General Manager of Farmers Union Oil Company at Alexandria. We have a location also in Garfield, convenience store. We deal in bulk fuels, propane. We have two convenience stores, a full service shop, tire department. And whenever you're coming by our location on Broadway or Garfield, we invite you to stop in and check out all the things we have to offer. We are a cooperative and we do pay dividends to our customers. And it is a true locally owned co-op where we are self-sufficient. We're owned by our members and all dividends, anything that's made here is paid back to our customers. So stop in and check us out and buy a tank of gas.
Remember to get your tanks filled at Sunex in Alexandria.
You're watching Inform TV, Alexandria, Minnesota.
Well, we're downtown here on Broadway with city engineer Tim. The kind of rumor going around town that there's some issues with the concrete, and Inform TV, we want you informed and much rather have you us talk to the source on what's going on a nice sunny day when they were not able to put any additional lanes like we talked to the concrete guy on Monday evening, I guess it was, and you guys got rained out on Tuesday. Tim, introduce yourself again for our viewers and kind of tell us what went on with the project today and what's the issues you're facing.
Sure, I'm Tim Schoenhoven. I'm the city engineer. Probably a lot of people have noticed the activity level today and yesterday isn't the same level as it's been. And the issue is a couple of different things. The rain, of course, yesterday was a problem. And then also there was a problem with some of the dowel bars. So the good news is the rain has stopped, it's sunny, it looks like the forecast is for dry weather, so that's a good thing. And the issue with the concrete dowel bars has been resolved as well. The concrete itself is fine, there's not an issue with the concrete of any kind, but there are these steel dowel bars that extend between the lanes, and the purpose of the dowel bars is to keep the lanes together so they don't move independently. This is one of them. The dowel bars, the issue that happened was the dowel bars are not adhering to the concrete exactly as they should be. There's kind of a mechanical issue that involved the paver. A lot of times these are put in with a paving machine, but these were placed by hand, which is an acceptable technique. A lot of times that works. But what they found when they took a look at these first part of this week is that the adhesion was not what they wanted. So they did a number of cores, about 9 cores, took a look at them and checked out to see how well they were attached, because the attachment is how they function. And they made a decision that what they're going to do is make a saw cut 12 inches remove these bars and remove that 12-inch piece of concrete, and then they'll drill new bars into the slab of concrete. Then they're epoxied in, and then when the new concrete comes through, that'll envelop the other bars, and it all becomes part of the final lane. So that's what we're after at this point.
Okay, that sounds good, Tim. Can we just step down, or do you step down and maybe show the people what we have down here right by your feet here, so they understand where these bars are? You can point right by your foot there, kind of show us.
This is a dowel bar. Those are 30-inch dowel bars, and okay. They're extended about 15 inches into the concrete.
Okay.
And they go in at an angle like this, and they push them in, and then they bend them out afterwards.
So for the next lane, and so what will we actually see? You will see a 12-inch chunk of concrete cut out around that on each one of them, or just some of them?
They're going to cut a 12-inch slice all the way down.
Oh, all the way down.
And they'll remove the outside 12 inches, and the bars will come out with them.
Okay.
And then they'll drill into the slab, put in the new bars, they'll epoxy those in, and then the paving will come and then it's paved just like it would have been before.
Okay, that's good to know. Yep. And so when the laying now, and I'll just kind of bring down the camera a little bit, by rather than laying two more 11-foot lanes, they'll probably end up laying a 12-foot to compensate for, because right over, when you look south here, this is 11-foot slab, right?
Yep, that's right.
And I think they planned on putting another 11 and then a 12 down the middle.
Right.
And you also said when we were prepping for this a little, the state pays for all the concrete, is that correct, Tim?
Yeah, the project, there are different levels of participation in all of this, but the concrete is 100% paid for by MnDOT. And so MnDOT had, you know, when they find a problem like this, they get their very best people, they are the smartest, best people in the state. So it goes down to the lab, goes to the concrete experts, they make a determination on what to do, and that's what they did in this case. So right away they get on it, they make a decision as fast as they can. 6 a.m. tomorrow morning, we'll be doing the saw cutting and doing the removal. So it happens pretty quickly.
So from a standpoint then, will this process be going on right in front? Will they start laying concrete tomorrow right away then, or is it going to take a day to do that?
Well, 4th of July weekend's coming.
Oh, that's right.
Tomorrow's Thursday, then Friday is the 4th, and so nobody's going to work on the 4th. So the plan right now, as I understand it, is to pave again Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Of the mainline paving.
And so tomorrow Thursday, they'll spend Thursday prepping this stuff, cutting these rods out.
Right.
And so when I'm just going to kind of look down here with the camera for my audience, Tim, so you can see there's a whole line of them, folks. In fact, I think they watched them being put in on a previous segment we had on Informed TV, but both sides here, they're going to cut them all, or just one of these lanes?
No, they'll cut all of the ones that were hand placed in. They'll cut off, so they'll cut 12 inches out of each of the two lanes that have already been poured.
So the people have been downtown here or watched Informed TV and saw these two lanes. Is that there'll be a 12-inch cut on all of it, or was there a segment that got put in right?
I'm not certain.
Okay.
I'm not certain.
Okay.
I think they're going to cut 12 inches for the most of it, at least. Let's say most of the full length.
And so I think the 11th was your target date. Is this going to extend that out then, probably till the following week? Is your thought, Tim?
It might be. We don't know that yet. We're going to work with the contractor and see about extending dates. There's been about maybe 3 days that this has taken that, you know, we're out of our schedule that we didn't anticipate. So it's possible. We're going to meet with the contractor and see what we can accelerate. There has been other work going on though. The traffic signals at 5th Avenue have been in. They've been pulling a lot of the electrical wires. That's been happening. There's grading that's going on. And those things will all continue as well. So that has been happening, and that'll happen tomorrow as well.
Does the cement contractor or Saline, do they have the drills and that type of thing to put these in, or will they bring somebody special in to do that?
I don't know.
Okay.
Somebody has them.
It looks to me like it'll be quite an undertaking, don't you think?
Yeah, I mean, there are always issues. This is a very complicated project, and there are always issues. There's an issue every day. And so they get on top of it as quickly as they can and deal with it.
We've got to interrupt you. We're fortunate enough to have the mayor here as well. And Mayor Carlson, I really appreciate you coming across the fence here, as they say.
Yep.
Tim's doing a good job of...
I'm sure Tim has explained it all. And we have one last thing that the guys want all our input on, but Tim has probably explained the issue. We had an issue. We've got a solution that's going to start tomorrow. And hopefully that will solve it. And we'll finish it up and get underway with the project again. So that's what I came to say and get Tim. And we've got a couple more things we've got to talk about.
I fully understand, Mayor. You've got an important job, but people want to be informed of what's going on. We've covered this extensively, and Tim did a good job.
Good.
Unless Tim's got one additional thought process that you want to say before the mayor pulls you.
No, I think that the contractor's still doing a good job. We keep working as hard as we can. Really good people working very hard to make this happen.
Absolutely.
Well, thanks for both of you to talk to Inform TV. Enjoy your 4th of July weekend, both of you.
You too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're watching Inform TV, Alexandria, Minnesota.
Here we got Jerry bringing in dignitaries to the construction site today. And Jerry, any good words from Roadrunner Taxi this morning?
Just beep, beep, get her done.
They'll get her done. It's kind of an impressive project, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, we'll catch you later.
Bye.
I just thought I better come back and show you folks the magnitude of what they're going to be doing, if I understand right, Tim Wright, and I'm sure I do, you listen to him as well. They're going to be cutting a foot piece off of this 11 foot wide piece of concrete that's 7 inches deep, and they'll remove the whole side. So this 11 foot slab you're looking at right now is going to end up being a 9 foot slab. And then they're going to also have to come in about every 30 inches and drill a hole in about 15 inches deep, when Tim explained to us a 30 inch rod. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of equipment they do to do that. You got to understand, we've got 7 inch deep concrete, so a task at hand in the morning is going to cut concrete that's 7 inches deep and remove a 12 inch piece, the equivalent of about 12 blocks long, because they're when we look at these slabs here, there's two slabs, so there's gonna have to be a foot off on each side, and for 3 blocks, so it'd be the equivalent, if my math is right, taking a foot off of concrete that's 7 inches deep for 12 blocks long. It will be quite a task, and then drill holes in on the side of that 7 inch concrete, as you can see there as I focus in 15 inches, and put epoxy and stick that rod in there. So we'll try to cover it for you tomorrow, but I would think this is gonna take at least a day, and hopefully they got some impressive equipment coming in. You know, today man has created a lot of interesting pieces of equipment, but it's going to take more than just a Briggs & Stratton motor and a little wheel blade, I would think. But we'll report on it tomorrow for you. But the more I thought about it, and when the mayor came over, and I was happy she did, I just didn't get to get Tim to put his foot up there and really explain it. But I'm sure I'm dead on target on that, and we'll give Tim and or the mayor to talk about it tomorrow as the project addresses this shortfall with these rods that the state is requiring to chop off a foot on each side of this 11 foot chunk of concrete on the east side, as well as another one on the west side over there. So it'll be an interesting to watch. Alan Repke reporting on Inform TV, Alexandria, Minnesota.
Hi, I'd like to invite you to stop by Dickman's Jewelry in downtown Alexandria to meet us next time you're in town. We offer a fine selection of jewelry and gifts for all the special occasions in your life at Dickman's Jewelry in downtown Alexandria.
As you can see, my team's ready to service you for all your plumbing and heating needs. Please give us a call.
Really Plumbing and Heating, ready to serve your needs.
I guess if I had any advice to another city that was considering doing what we did, I would say definitely look at the potential and the end result. The dynamics of shopping have changed. If you don't improve, if you don't change, if you don't grow, if you don't get better, business stalls, people quit coming, becomes less interesting. This just brings more people, brings the experience to your town. And I think people are in this generation are looking for an experience.
You know, the real fortunate part was all the people that got on board.
At WSN, we were fortunate enough to be involved from the very beginning. The project started about 4 years before construction in 2010.
When we started the business, we had probably 15 choices of where we could locate our business. Lots of empty buildings. The potential that this could be a really, really great location. So, and as it's turned out after the complete streets, was a good move.
Like many of the construction projects that happen in Minnesota, we have just a short amount of time to get road construction projects done. And of course, that coincided exactly with our heaviest season of tourism.
Tourist season, obviously, is where we thrive and grow, and that was the biggest concern.
So there was a lot of worry about that. You know, how are we going to do this?
How are we going to attract people to still come down here, even though we're kind of in what looks to be total chaos?
MnDOT initially planned this to be a mill and overlay project, where they were going to come in and mill 3 or 4 inches of asphalt and just fill it back again. So you get a nice, smooth riding surface, but that's all you get.
But the reality was businesses were having a hard time with sewer and water lines breaking.
We had abandoned steam lines that were in here. The power was old. Everything was old here in the project, and we wanted to replace that. And so the idea was to have a partnership with MnDOT, and it turned out just to be a great partnership.
Complete Streets is a program that MnDOT sponsors, and they're fairly strict about what their project should look like.
So instead of just focusing on trucks and cars, Complete Streets Project also looks at all the other modes of transportation.
Kind of like building a house. You know, would you build your own house and then not put in trees or shrubs or shutters or flowers on the front step? Of course not.
This is a major project that's going to be very, very disruptive. There's no getting around that. And we had to do it in such a way that the businesses could survive and could actually thrive.
Community engagement is number one top priority for any project to happen when you're talking about ripping up a whole downtown.
Mike Weber, Tim Schoenhoven, and myself, with a few meetings, came in, set up in this conference room, and interviewed every person, every business owner, and everybody who rented a shop up and down Broadway. We also had input meetings on what Broadway and the amenities should look like.
And they were conceptual meetings, and they said, how about this, how about this?
Here's what it looks like. What do you think would make it better?
How about lane configuration? How about parking? How does all this stuff come together?
What do you think this should look like? Here's what the benches are going to look like. Here's what the bollards are going to look like.
And those meetings really started everything that we did here.
A lot of people came in and said, we don't want a bench there. We don't want a tree there. But when you heard them and then said, here's why and here's the plus of it, most of them went, oh, I never thought of that.
We had a landscape architect firm on board. It was the Toisington Poyler Group out of Minneapolis, and specifically Amy Bauer. And she came with all of her skills and took a look at all this job and incorporated the colored sidewalk and the way the pavers work, the way the planters work, the way the plants work and the streets and the trees. And there's so much little detail to it. And it was the coming together, that the blending of it, that was really the trick. And that's really what Amy brought to it. I think she did a great job.
Public perception was really the reason that the road committee started in the first place. We realized that it was very important for us to have this very positive view of what was going to happen.
That's part of what made the project so successful, was communication, communication, communication.
8 different partners surfaced to the top as primary partners within that group and would have a say.
And when you get that whole group together talking, they have fantastic ideas.
We wanted to make sure that because the downtown project would affect the Downtown Merchants Association the greatest, that they definitely were at the table and giving input the whole time through that process.
WITSEP did a great job of coming to the downtowners meetings, I think calming fears.
We kept access to the businesses at all times. Even if it was temporary access, they always had it. But still, it's disruptive when they're right in front of you. We phased this project from start to finish, actually went from north to south, in 3 different phases. The general premise was phase 1 had to be done and open to traffic before you could go to phase 2. And so if you were a business, you knew that the maximum amount of time was going to be torn up right in front of you was going to be 6 weeks.
The road crew became kind of a buffer. Tim and his crew would relay the construction detailed information back to us. But it was our job to then buffer it to the community, so it was more in layman's terms for them to understand.
I actually had copies of all the plans. I could show those to customers. They loved seeing them. They were very interested in what was going to happen. I taped a radio ad in many of the other businesses that just said, we're open, come down. We have back parking lots. We stayed positive about it, reinforcing that it wasn't hazardous. There's lots of ways to get to all of us. We're open for business like always.
I wrote an article once a week in the newspaper called The Buzz on Broadway, talking about what's happening. The local radio station, the local newspaper, everybody got on board. And the more you get people on board, the better it is, obviously.
2 events that started during the construction that were really just a far-fetched dream at the time would be the downtown's party in the street. The other was to have an art and wine crawl so people could actually look at the construction right in front of them.
And when we did this, you know, we were expecting 1,000 people. We had 2,500 people come down to this last year. And I remember walking out front and Sarah Carlson, the mayor, and the chamber, Connie, were out front. And I'm like, see guys, look, there's like 1,000,000 people on the street. There are people all the way around these planters. I mean, it was just exactly what we thought would happen. And who doesn't like to see like a whole full street? We need a party in the street. We need a big thing to bring people downtown. And they looked around and they go, you're absolutely right.
And those events have continued now this year.
So it's going to be an annual event, which this town has never had.
The wine and art crawl then, they ended up adding a second one towards the end of the summer. And then this summer they have 3 of them that are scheduled throughout the summer as well.
Along with the streetscape and everything that happened, I think everybody just kind of said, you know, this looks amazing. This really turned out beautiful. Now we need to just step it up too. People took advantage of doing something extra to their back to clean it up, make it look more presentable. You know, new awnings, new signs. We painted the back of our building. So with all of that happening, I mean, it not only increased the real estate, but it just increased the traffic flow, the customer counts, and all of our businesses have gone up. The end result was increase in business. Does my heart good to look outside and see benches filled with people? We want people to come down. We want them to sit at the tables. We want them to sit on the benches, have coffee, have wine, have lunch. And I think the complete streets really added to that whole experience.
My name is Lane Kalena, General Manager of Farmers Union Oil Company at Alexandria. We have a location also in Garfield, convenience store. We deal in bulk fuels, propane. We have 2 convenience stores, a full service shop, tire department. And whenever you're coming by our location on Broadway or Garfield, we invite you to stop in and check out all the things we have to offer. We are a cooperative and we do pay dividends to our customers, and it is a true locally owned co-op where we are self-sufficient. We're owned by our members, and all dividends, anything that's made here, is paid back to our customers. So stop in and check us out and buy a tank of gas.
Alexandria, please stop by. Nightly specials and happy hour 7 days a week.
Come enjoy our upstairs entertainment. We have pool tables, dartboards, jukebox. We have a DJ every weekend.
And we have our huge salad bar available 7 days a week.
Come join us for a meal in our spacious downstairs dining room.
If you have a larger group, we can accommodate you in our upstairs dining area. You can seat about 75 people up here.
We're going to talk to Tim this Friday, city engineer. We've got some powwows, some issues going on Broadway again. Yesterday they mixed the cement wrong for sidewalk, but we're going to check out here and see that some of the rumors that we're getting are also true. Inform TV, we've got state people everywhere on Broadway today, this Friday. But we've got some activity going, but whether it's positive or negative, we're going to try to find that out here. And city engineer Tim in just a little bit. You see we got Markley Excavation bringing some gravel in, or fill, whatever. And we're going to try to get to the bottom of this issue today, as we have a lot of people standing around and not a whole lot of people working other than Mark Lee's group. This is a big powwow we're having today. We're going to try to get these guys. It looks like Celine, looks like this cement guy, and our city engineer Tim. So hopefully we're going to get some answers here pretty damn quick. And as you can see, we also got a fresh patch in the brand new concrete on Broadway as well as some problems with sidewalk coloring that we're going to ask him about as well. Now we got our city engineer covered up with two contractors there, and it's like at least three MnDOT people, and so hopefully we're going to get some answers here before too long on what the Sam heck is going on with this project in downtown Alexandria.
You're watching Inform TV, Alexandria, Minnesota.
We're in downtown Alexandria. Tim, we hear there were some issues with just coloring some sidewalk on Thursday. Now over my shoulder, there looks like there's a 6x6 patch or something in some of the new concrete, as well as there's rumors going around town. There's some issues with some of the lanes out there that may have to be redone or anything like that. What's all going on? Lot 8? State workers surveying and all that kind of thing. So kind of give us an update.
Sure. The state workers, you know, it's a state city-state partnership project. And so those guys have been down quite a bit all the time. And so we've got guys down here again from MnDOT. We're happy to have them. They're great guys. They do a really good job. They're great partners. So whenever they come down to help, we're really glad to see them. A lot of really good stuff going today. They're pouring sidewalk. Across the road there, Mark Lee is putting in some growth medium for where the trees go. It's kind of like a beehive, you know, lots and lots of activity. The little patch, it was just they missed a valve, so they just had to cut that out to fix that. Colored concrete is going in. There's three different colors. I think they're doing the red today. They did the brown the day before. So that's really going pretty well.
What about some elevation or a lane problem? That rumor's buzzing. Is there any issues with some of these lanes?
Well, there's a lot of rumors. There's some elevations on the outside lane of the parking, or outside elevation of the parking lane that we're looking at right now. And it's possible that we're going to have to make some adjustments to some of the panels. We're working on that right now, working with the contractor and figuring that out.
Potentially jackhammering some of them out?
It could be. We'll have to see what the solutions are, but if they have to be removed, then what they'll do is they'll saw cut them in and jackhammer them out.
Are we talking issues 100 feet long, 200 feet long, one city block and not another? What are you thinking?
There are no issues north of 5th
okay.
at all. And south of 5th, we don't know yet. We're kind of working those out.
So that's the potential problems that they're studying today as far as... The issues they're studying today, then, that relates to issues with potential concrete and elevation from 5th north?
Yeah, what we're doing is we're just checking some of the panel elevations along the parking lane to make sure that those are right.
And
then we'll just work with the contractor to get that.
So it's mainly out on the parking lane, not in the traffic lanes?
The traffic lanes all seem to be just right.
Just right. It's the stuff that was put in on the parking side. Is it one side of the street, east or west, or there are issues at both sides?
Yeah, well, we're trying to figure out what the extent is, and if there is an issue, how big it is, and then what we'll do with it. We're kind of working on that right now.
Will you have an answer for us this afternoon, you think, later?
It's hard to know. But I'll have an answer within at least a couple of days.
Okay, real good. Thanks, Tim, for taking time.
Thanks.
We've got the cutter guy back, so we'll see what happens.
From TV, we're out on Broadway here about 5 o'clock. As you see, they did get some sidewalk open on the 500 block here, heading north. So shoppers, you can come on down. But my sources are also telling me that it's quite likely they're going to cut out some of this parking lane stuff, maybe a block or two, one side for sure. Maybe both. So we're going to try to get a hold of Tim, the engineer. I've been talking to state guys, and obviously this project, in my view, is at the point in time when the state needs to take it over and get the job done. This is Highway 29. This isn't a city development project, and a lot of blame to go around. I'm not blaming any of them, but in particular. But obviously, with the issues we've had in concrete on this project to date, it is a disgrace. And the state needs to step in and get some people here and start doing watching on an hour-by-hour basis. We'll see what we can find out from the city engineer. Well, I did get the word on the 500 block here. On Broadway here, you see the red marks there. Something to do about the concrete, elevation, whatever. They're going to be cutting off out the parking lane. You see the red marks here. Everything to the east of this, both the curb and gutters going out, as well as the parking lane, is going to be removed. And I did see the cutting truck go by. And then we'll go on the other side, and a similar thing over there. But Alan Repke reporting on additional problems on the Broadway project here in downtown Alexandria.
You're watching Inform TV, Alexandria, Minnesota.
Now we're on the west side of the 500 block, and you can see they did kind of a slot in this concrete. Tim, he gave me a little explanation on it, but I'm not quite sure what he meant. But I'm on the 500 block now, and you can see the marking lines are put up there. That this as well is not on the right elevation, that type of thing. And they haven't put the curb and gutter in here yet, but as you can see, the marks from a competent source that didn't want to go on camera said there is going to be at least 75 yards of concrete that's going to be replaced probably Monday, and hopefully it'll be cut off here. But you can see this is the parking lane on the west side, and they've already got a preliminary mark. And my little piece there will show that the cutting machine is back in town. So, Alan Repke reporting on a job site that is becoming kind of a nightmare and needs some new supervision in this reporter's view.
that's been around a lot of projects in his day. So it's probably better than ever. Come on down and see what's going on here. One thing they did do is they've got the sidewalks open again on both sides. It's obviously gravel, but I still encourage you to come on and support the businesses on the 500 block here that have some issues, and hopefully are going to finally get resolved and get this project rolling and keep rolling. Now we'll give you a little idea what your future sidewalk is going to look like in downtown Alexandria here on the 400 block. And as the colors and some of the open area is starting to be exposed, and just give you a little thought process that way, and you can see how wide this is. And obviously I would think you'd be able to come down tomorrow and walk on this. And so I encourage you to come down and look at the project, where it seems endless problems, but hopefully they'll eventually get it taken care of. The issue I double checked with my sources on that 500 block up there, and for whatever reason they didn't get the right angle on that to move the water over to the curb and the storm sewer like it was supposed to be. And when I looked at it with my camera, they had a pretty good level approach, did a lot of water drainage tile and that kind of thing in my day, and it looked awful flat to me, and probably shows on my camera angle it's flat as well. Just the angle to get the water to move where it's supposed to appears one of the major issues, and who knows what else. But just trying to give you an idea of the issues on Broadway here in downtown Alexandria, but make sure you get downtown to support the local businesses that are paying a price for whatever's going on down here, other than what should be, of course. So we'll try to do a follow-up as well, and still trying to get in charter, but City Hall looks like they are going to continue to block me that way, unfortunately. But censorship is a great power, and the people I need to be talking to can't get this message. Just in case you don't believe me, as you can see, folks, on Friday afternoon, I'm up at the airport, 6 o'clock now. I don't have a watch. Can't afford a battery for it. But you can see they're cutting off parking lanes on the left side here of the 500 block. They've already started there. Did a nice stretch already. So this whole side is going to go off. Everything to the dark side, the store side here, people are going off. And what I showed you before, on the west side with the new curb and gutter there, that's going off with another chunk of concrete this size as well. Alan Repke reporting.
Now I want you to think this way. On this project, you should have by now have saw how they had to cut pieces along the edge as far as throw massive amounts of concrete away. And yet, what should happen on this project? The state, in the case of Minnesota, the state legislative auditor, the transportation committee of our legislature should come in and see what really went on here. What was the true cost of this project when we didn't have sound oversight? And with our policies today, this project, they would dig it open during the day, fill it in every afternoon, and then dig it out in the morning again so some drunk would fall in and hurt himself, or some idiot snooping where they have no right to be. So take a look at that as well. It's very interesting going forward.
Inform TV is going to show you a little of the work when Mayor Carlson, Virgil Basil, Todd Jensen, Owen Miller, Roger Thune, David Benson, Marty, our city administrator, Tom, our city attorney, and our city engineer are all watching out for the taxpayer in a major project here in downtown Alexandria. And the incredible thing, Owen Miller thinks he should be a county commissioner after we have continued screw-up after screw-up with this city government here in Alexandria. You can see why all of them don't want a true press source in the area. Look at this. I mean, you talk about outrage. I gave these people a bunch of warning that I was going to continue to cover this project and the incompetence that's going on here in downtown Alexandria. Everybody in Douglas County should be reading out your county commissioners, your legislative people. This is an absolute disgrace. We have government in Alexandria is run by the Keystone Cops of City Hall. And when we're tearing out good concrete on a daily basis because nobody is supervising the project, it's an outrage. And I hope you contact your city council member and show up for their meeting on Monday night and give them your viewpoint of the incompetence of this project. The city of Alexandria is the laughing stock in the Alexandria Lakes area and all of outstate Minnesota all of a sudden with this project. The state needs to come in and take this thing over and treat it as Highway 29 and get the project done. This is outrageous. Alan Repke reporting. Incompetent
You're watching Inform TV, Alexandria, Minnesota.
Here's your concrete contractor. Sidewalk layout here again in this Broadway project. What's that going to look like? They do have a laser level up. I wonder if they have anybody that knows how to read the damn thing. They certainly haven't anybody that knows great. Alan Repke reporting the incompetence in the Broadway project here in downtown Alexandria. It's Saturday the 12th, as it starts to sprinkle, we'll give you one last look of project that is led by total and complete incompetence, starting first and center with City Hall, the mayor, and your council members. Alan Repke reporting on a disastrous project here in downtown Alexandria. No leadership whatsoever.
Welcome to Little Darlings.
Hi. I'm Jean at Little Darlings. At Little Darlings, we are getting ready for Christmas. We have lots of holiday apparel. We have toys, books, everything for little hands and little imaginations. A selection of baptism attire. Lots of Melissa and Doug. Playette area features diaper bags, swaddles, all things children, infant to size 6X.
In Alexandria.
Right on Broadway in Alexandria.
Hi, welcome to Randy's Menswear. I'm Randy. If you haven't been to Randy's Menswear, you haven't been to a real men's store. We have styles to fit men of any taste and any needs. We have big and tall sizes, short and small sizes, dress clothing, casual clothing. If it's for men, we probably have it. Stop in and visit us during this holiday season at Randy's Menswear. And visit us during this holiday season at Randy's Menswear.
Beautiful day here in Alexandria. Why don't you come into Dickman's Jewelry? I'll show you around.
So we do clock, watches, and with a lot of watches, people like their watch. They got on vacation, this or that. I can get a new movement for some of these quartzes that maybe some people would feel they have to either throw away or put in a drawer. But no, I can take care of the watches, the ring work, the complete jewelry. We do things like engraving. We can't do crystal, but we can do any metal if our machine holds it, which is kind of a nice service. So you can customize a picture frame or a clock, even things that weren't bought here. So we do that. My sister does restringing of pearls, so you can get those family heirlooms back on. And it's like I say, we try to be a complete service store.